Thank you very much. Straight to business. I welcome to the 5th meeting of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing in 2015. Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as interview with broadcasting, even when they've been switched to silent? There's no apologies. I welcome Graham Pearson and Roderick Campbell, but I'll say to both of you, as I did previously, because this committee has been functions on the basis that we represent other committees, I'll take members' questions first. Before I take visiting MSPs. Number one, decision to take business in private, that's to consider our work programme. Are you agreed? Thank you very much. Straight on to item two, armed policing, which is a continuing evidence session, which began on 5th of March, and we have the same witnesses before us. And thank you very much for returning. Iain Whyte, Scottish Police Authority Board member, who chaired its recent inquiry into the public impact of Police Scotland's standing of Firearms Authority, Deputy Chief Constable Iain Livingstone, Crime and Operational Support, Assistant Chief Constable Bernard Higgins, Operational Support, Derek Penman, HM Inspector of Constabulary in Scotland, who also recently reported on Standing Firearms Authority. And I'll go straight to questions from members. Margaret first, followed by Alison. Margaret.
All right. Good afternoon, gentlemen. And perhaps I could ask Mr Whyte, last week when I asked of you how communication would be improved between SPA and Police Scotland, you referred to the joint agreement, which was on policy engagement, and you said that this would bring the issue of significant public interest into play. That would be the test, in effect, of when prior notice would be given of a policy change. How will you gauge significant public interest?
Okay.
You've all been here before. Mr Whyte.
Well, I think the question was to me, convener. Significant public interest is quite a broad term, and the reason we don't want to define it in any more detail is similar to that around operational policing. We don't want to exclude things from consideration. Clearly, to begin with, if matters come up within Police Scotland and within Police Scotland's knowledge, there would be an expectation that Police Scotland will make some decisions about what is of significant public interest. I would hope that they will be, as they have given us an indication, conducting various community impact assessments around things, and that those community impact assessments would include public interest and as one of the items within them, and that they will bring those to us. I would also hope that there will be a more informal aspect of this, where if Police Scotland had something that they thought might be of interest, then they have a discussion with our officers in SPA to see whether that is jointly agreed as something of significant interest and brought forward in that way. And similarly, we at SPA may raise things. There are various things that we do raise from time to time with Police Scotland, and we have a number of mechanisms that test issues for us. We, for instance, have quarterly meetings with the trade unions. We have quarterly meetings with staff associations, and issues come up there. We obviously have links to local authorities, and each of us has up to four local authorities that we have a link relationship with, and they raise things with us. And indeed, your own committee and some of the informal sessions we've had to discuss things have raised things in the past. So there are a whole host of ways that issues come to our attention, and we would raise those too.
I'm afraid that doesn't really inspire me with too much confidence, given we're hoping for quite a lot here, and given the background to why we're talking about communication in the first place, which is, in the first instance, there was an argument whether it was operational or a policy decision at all. Even when it was established as a policy decision, there was no real appreciation of the importance of it until there was significant public concern raised after the event. So isn't it the case that the only way to be absolutely sure would be for all policy decisions to be transmitted and referred to SPA?
Well, policy decisions, convener, will be referred to SPA. That's the nature of how matters are discussed and decided. And the joint agreement is very clear that there will be advance engagement on future policy decisions. The Chief Constable has signed up to that, and I understand what Mrs. Mitchell says about how things may have been characterised in the summer of last year. I believe that things have moved on considerably since then, and the wording in the joint agreement is clear about that. We've also tasked our Chief Executive to work with the Chief Constable to come up with a way of monitoring that that agreement is in place and is delivering.
It's the significant public interest test.
Yes.
How do you test that?
I believe that the firearms issue became one of significant public interest.
But it became
that much later than the point where the policy was determined. Indeed, a year and a bit, or at least a year, after the decision had been taken and the officers were acting in a different way throughout Scotland. So some of these things in the past were not dealt with in as open a way as I would have liked. And I believe with the joint agreement that we now have in place and the commitments I've seen in recent weeks from Police Scotland, that we can take that forward in a much better way in the future. And ultimately, that's what we're here as an authority to do, is to improve the performance of policing in Scotland and make things better for the future, more open for the public too.
I'm confused. Why is there a significant public interest test if all policy decisions are going to come to you in advance?
Because there may be things that are not a matter of policy as such, but they raise a significant public interest, and there would be value in airing those before the authority in an open public meeting.
So is this a catch-all
then? It's to allow it to be wider than simply a policy change that Police Scotland might bring forward, or to allow it to be wider so that should we request a discussion with Police Scotland about a particular policy, we can raise that.
So are we going into operational matters then?
Well, there are operational... I think we covered operational matters last time. There are specific policing operations that are a matter for the Chief Constable. There are issues that arise out of policies that Police Scotland put in place to deal with operational issues that are policy issues, and those in terms of ensuring that there is public oversight and that there is public consent for Police Scotland and what they're doing should be matters that are aired publicly, and that the obvious place to begin that process is within the SPA and open public meetings.
I was going to call you anyway, Mr. Penman, because I realise you've comments to make about this agreement, joint agreement. So,
thank you, Commissioner. It's probably just to try and clarify the situation best I can. Personally, I think we're further forward than we were 6 months ago around accountability. We took opportunity in our report to discuss operational responsibility. Operational responsibility is where the Chief Constable would be responsible or accountable to the authority for both operational and non-operational decisions that he has taken. So he's accountable effectively for everything that he does. The SPA have taken opportunity in their firearms report to set out what effectively is a statutory framework of accountability. It takes the legislation within the Police and Fire Reform Act and sets out how they think they would hold the Chief Constable to account in terms of the legislation. I think that's helpful because I think it says quite clearly that the Chief Constable is accountable to the authority for the policing of Scotland. Policing of Scotland, to me, is operational and non-operational, so I think the distinction becomes less important because the authority have the opportunity to challenge and test the Chief Constable publicly in relation to his policing of Scotland. I think that the potential weakness in that, I think, was identified by committee members, is that can sometimes be after the fact. And in some respects, it's done before then. What the attempt has been, I think, through the joint agreement on the police policy engagement is for the Chief Constable and the authority to agree protocol that they will bring policy decisions to them beforehand. That will rely on the Chief Constable and his professional judgment to some extent to make sure that they come through. What I would say, I think, though, is the safeguard exists now that should that not take the place, the authority have the opportunity to hold the Chief to account for the decision he makes, but also now, I think, to be held to account for why it wasn't brought forward in terms of that protocol. So I think it has moved us on quite a bit in the last 6 months.
So how do you see the significant public interest test working?
I think the intention behind that would be that Police Scotland would do a community impact assessment, effectively looking at what would be the impact on wider communities around the decision that was taken. I think that, in some respects, will be a professional judgment, but I would hope that that would set the scene for a kind of threshold that was there. As I say, there's still a safeguard, I think, that if it was deemed that didn't meet that and it then came through and it became public interest, there is a bit around, I think, going back to revisit that decision. I think that the joint agreement and the engagement is quite an important thing. Next week, we'll be publishing a report on Stop Search. We will be making recommendations that are likely to be changes to policy decisions, and we have said in our report that our expectation would be that the Chief Constable and the Authority will adhere to their agreement in discussing these changes to policy. So I think it's an important document that we have to allow the Authority and the Police Service to use and have the ability to check if it's been done.
Thanks.
Thank you. I've got Alison, followed by Elaine, followed by John. Alison.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, gentlemen. Towards the end of the last meeting, we were beginning to explore in more detail the deployment of ARV officers. And I think it would be helpful for committee to understand a bit more about the day-to-day deployment. Are they active in all divisions? And are there variations on how they are deployed, depending on whether it's a daytime shift or a nighttime shift?
Certainly.
ACC Higgins, please. Yeah, yes, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I think, again, just to clarify exactly what the operating parameters of our armed response vehicles are. And again, we've made it very clear since the 1st of October in numerous public forums, not least here on the 5th of March. ARV officers will be deployed. They will be sent to firearms incidents and other incidents that fall within a threat to life category. That is the only incidents the ARVs will be deployed to from the area control rooms. However, on a daily basis, they are deployed to patrol in every part of Scotland. Part of that patrol matrix has them covering iconic sites, has them covering vulnerable premises in line with the current terrorist threat in the country. So they are out patrolling the streets of Scotland. Whilst they are not sent to what has been referred to as routine incidents, should something occur in front of them, then my expectation, that of Mr. Livingstone's, and I would imagine every member of the Scottish public, is that they will make a professional assessment on how they deal with that matter that has occurred in front of them. And as I reported at the last committee meeting, up to and including the 1st of April, they have done so on 1,644 occasions. But I must emphasise that that is not 1,644 incidents they have attended. That is 1,644 occasions when something has occurred in them, in front of them, and they've dealt with it. You know, so for example, a couple of months ago in Glasgow, an armed response vehicle was stopped by a member of the public to tell them that a road accident had occurred just round the corner. They went, a car had collided with a lamppost. The driver was drunk, he was disqualified, and the car he was driving was stolen. So whilst that is neither a firearms incident nor a threat to life, my expectations is that they would have dealt with that, and they did. To answer your question specifically, Mr. McInnes, yes, they are deployed right across the country. On a daily basis, they are given a patrol matrix to follow, which will have them in particular areas as determined by the threat profile, and they have the parameters to use their professional assessment to deal with the things that occur in front of them.
And are they deployed differently in the night shift than night time?
I'm sorry, in what respect?
Well, do they have the same sort of matrix to follow?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, they do.
So the HMIC's review of the Standing Firearms Authority said that armed officers have completed more than 11,000 hours of directed patrols in local divisions and over 18,000 hours of default patrols. Do those two categories still exist? Can you explain a little bit more about what those two categories are?
Yeah, directed patrols was prior to the 1st of October.
Okay.
And that would be when a local division had a particular issue in a particular area. So, for example, cars on a particular road in Glasgow were speeding.
Okay.
And they would ask and request the ARVs when they had downtime, they would go into that area and deal with the speeding vehicles. So that is directed patrols. Default patrols is exactly that. When you are not engaged in a firearms or threat to life incident, you revert to the patrol matrix, which I've explained takes the cars into areas of vulnerability for a whole variety of reasons.
Okay, that's helpful. Can you tell me if ARV patrols have been present in the vicinity of nightclubs on a regular basis?
Potentially they would have. For example, they will routinely patrol past George Square because the City Chambers is an iconic building. George Square is in the middle of Glasgow, so it's well within the realms of possibility that to get to George Square, they will drive up Queen Street, which has a number of nightclubs on it.
And have ARV officers issued fixed penalty notices for minor breaches of the peace or drinking in a public place or urinating in the street?
Yes, they have on many occasions.
So you consider that to be things happening in front of them?
Yes, indeed.
Yes.
And as I say, we ask the officers to use their professional judgment. And again, the professional judgment can range from an informal warning to, as you quite rightly say, formal ticketing. But again, I have to emphasise here that the firearms officers, in my view, receive the most intensive training in terms of their situational awareness and their decision-making. And that, over the course of the year, is tested intensely. We have a real scrutiny around their decision-making in terms of their refresher training. And if there's any doubt about that, then they are not permitted to carry out the duties of a firearms officer. So I would actually contend that those officers demonstrate a far higher level of situational awareness and decision-making than any other officer in the force.
So are you able to tell me how many fixed penalty notices have been issued by armed officers?
Do you wish that from the 1st of October?
Yes.
Right, well, that forms part of the figure of 1644. And in terms of antisocial behaviour, fixed penalty notices, they have issued 207.
Okay.
Contextually, Police Scotland in the same period have issued 21,044.
Okay.
So the armed response vehicles have accounted for roughly 0.9% of all fixed penalty notices issued.
Can I just press you on the patrol matrix that you mentioned then? How is that decided in terms of weekend work and things like that? Are you deploying ARV as an extra resource at busy times round about nightclubs and things?
No.
Like that?
The ARVs have a very specific duty, and that is to mitigate the highest threat against the communities of Scotland.
Yes.
And that is people intent on causing harm through using extreme levels of violence. Now, whether that's with a firearm or whether it's because they're deemed to be otherwise so dangerous because they're armed with a samurai sword. We overlay that against the current threat level, and simply because it's a weekend doesn't make a particular area less vulnerable to attack.
Mm-hmm.
So the patrol matrix is based on their duty to protect life and to be available to mitigate the highest levels of threat against the communities of Scotland, but also to contribute to the current our current response to the UK threat level.
I think it's helpful to understand that detail. Thank you. I'll let you move on, but if I could ask, since April 2013, has any part of any firearms officer's equipment been seized by a member of the public or been the subject of an attempted seizure by a member of the public?
Absolutely not.
No.
And I think, again, Convener, it might be helpful to say that the current modes of carriage we have several locking mechanisms of it, and as part of the officer's training, they are trained in terms of defensive techniques to prevent that happening. But in terms of your question, there has been no attempt for any member of the public or other person to try and seize or gain access to any weapon carried by a Police Scotland officer.
And if that had happened, clearly that would be reported and perhaps also reported to HMICS?
It would, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I beg your pardon.
Just to add to the point Ms. McInnes is raising about what the firearms officers do when they're not doing threat to life or they're not doing firearms jobs. And that's the point, that's the second point I talked about, I think, at the last session about mode of carriage and actual deployment. So ACC Higgins has underlined today some of the instances that might arise, mm-hmm. that ARV officers have responded to because it's happened in front of them. And what we're now going to do is actually we're going to go and consult. We're going to actually look for a criteria, because that was one of the recommendations that came from the HMI, that Police Scotland should do that. And again, in response to some of the earlier questions of the last session, I said that we'll make sure that that's thorough, that there's understanding of that, and an extension of the conversation that you and Bernie have had just now is something that we want to do right across the country. So actually, people will say to us, actually, we don't think that ARV officers should do that, or we think that they should do more of that because it would be counterintuitive and against the public interest for them not to respond to somebody who was a drunk driver or who was assaulting their partner or whatever the issue was. So that element of deployment of ARV officers, not actually tasked, but officers and ARV officers who are going to deal with instances in front of them that are not firearms and not threat to life, that's the key element that we're going to go and consult on and get some criteria around, because we've committed to support and accept the recommendations of Mr. Penman.
Okay. Elaine.
thank you, Convener. We know that each ARV officers are required to remove the handguns when attending training, and they're not allowed to carry them in court. But other than that, as you've described, it's left to the judgment of the police officer as to when it's appropriate or not. There has been some suggestion that guidance should be provided for officers on how firearms should be handled when they need to leave the ARV and when not responding to operational incidents. And I wondered, is any bit guidance being drawn up? Has that been considered at all?
The officers, as part of their training, already have that guidance in terms of the default position is that when they operate on control, with the exceptions of training and going to court, then they carry their sidearm and their taser on their person. If for whatever reason they have to disarm themselves, then that is a standard procedure which they learn during their basic ARV training.
Okay. Because one of the complaints I had in my constituency, and admittedly this was before the 1st of October, was a constituent observing an ARV officer doing a shopping in the supermarket while armed with a Glock 17, which obviously caused a bit of distress. I mean, is that considered to be appropriate, that an officer should be going about, presumably he was still on duty and was getting something to eat, I presume. But is that considered to be appropriate, that somebody would be in a setting like a supermarket whilst carrying a Glock 17?
Well, certainly since the 1st of October, I mean, I certainly wouldn't expect them to be pushing a trolley around the supermarket. That would be completely inappropriate. But what we have said is part of your overall awareness, if you have to go and buy a sandwich or buy, a bottle of water, then again, use your professional judgment. And my expectation is that no, Saturday afternoon at 3 o'clock in any supermarket is probably not a place where they should be doing it. They should go to the petrol station next to the supermarket and buy their sandwich or their water there. And that message has been constantly reinforced in terms of what we do with our officers, and on a daily basis, it's reinforced as part of their briefing and their deployment plan.
So now, in terms of the guidance they receive during training, would police officers who are entitled to carry arms, would they be advised, as you've just said, that they shouldn't be going into the supermarket with their weapons on their person?
No, I would never constrain my officers with that. What I would say to them is that, as I've said in many occasions, they have to use their situational awareness training. They used to have their professional judgment. And if they are going into a 24-hour supermarket at 3 o'clock in the morning, where there are very few members of the public around, and actually there's more members of the public in the petrol station forecourt, then personally I wouldn't have a huge problem with that at all. It depends on the particular circumstance of the time. As I've said, if it's 3 o'clock in the Saturday afternoon, it's not something I would expect them to do. If it's 3 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, then perhaps it's more acceptable.
How is that communicated to officers now in terms of advice even? I don't know, you're saying that officers will use a professional judgment, but is there advice given to officers about the appropriateness of they carry their weapons?
It's constantly reinforced to them. At the start of every tour of duty, the officers have to take a declaration and a warning in terms of how they operate as part of their briefing prior to them going on onto the streets. They are reminded about their personal responsibilities, not only in terms of when they can and cannot discharge a firearm, but actually exactly what we are just talking about just now, the situations that they put themselves in, and to make sure that they are not going to be put in a difficult position. Mm-hmm. And as I've said, my very firm belief is that the training and the refresher training that these officers receive make them, in my view, the most skilled in this particular area.
Margaret Mitchell spoke about the issues of communication earlier on. I wondered what specific steps are being taken to improve communication with the public and with local authorities in terms of, you know, obviously there was a communication issue between the SPA and Police Scotland, but equally there were problems of communication with local authorities and the communities they represent. I wonder what steps have now been taken to ensure that there are clear lines of communication over, particularly over operational matters which could cause public concern.
First thing I would say, Ms. Murray, was that we accept that we didn't do as much communication engagement, and indeed with the existing links and relationships built on many years of trust that we had, I think on reflection and perhaps inevitably, but nevertheless on reflection, we were introspective and quite transactional in the early days and months when this new organisation was coming together. And one of the fundamental bits of learning that has come from the whole debate and discussion around armed policing is to make sure that we don't back away from these relationships and links that have been established over many years. So a key factor, a key element has been the role of the local divisional commander, the role of the local area commanders, the networks into community groups, the networks into local policing local authority scrutiny panels, the networks into business, into community groups, volunteer groups, all the instances that were there. And again, I think I perhaps said it the last time, they were there and remain there. So we need to mobilise them, we need to map them out, and we need to be very, very active and deliberate in our engagement with them. And we wholly take that on board, and it is a matter of reflection. We are in a different place. We're, you know, a matter of days away from 2 years into Police Scotland. And over that period of time, we need to make sure that we will engage with that vast array of networks that I outlined.
Mm-hmm. So how are you going to monitor that?
Convener, can I maybe add something to that? Because it's important to recognise that along with the joint agreement about communication between Police Scotland and the SPA, at our last board meeting, we also had Police Scotland's communication and engagement strategy presented to us. I see the DCC has a copy with them here on the table. And we will be looking to monitor that and make sure that its aspects are implemented. And we've tasked our chief executive to go away and...
I beg your pardon, I was trying to get something. Is this about the report that's to come out?
This is about how we monitor communications and engagement going forward. Convener. So we will be looking to have our chief executive draw up a proposal as to how we monitor performance against that communications and engagement strategy. We also, as part of the firearms review that we undertook in the report, commissioned some expert academic input. And that was about, particularly about strategic police engagement. And that information has been provided from the University of Cardiff, has been provided to Police Scotland as to advise and inform Police Scotland's approach to communication and engagement going forward. We would hope they would found on that in the work they do in terms of both their communication strategy and the work in engaging with the authority, and indeed we can hold them to account around that type of work. And one final thing, convener, we are carrying forward our programme of work with local authorities, and indeed tomorrow we have a partners in scrutiny event with COSLA at which 21 of Scotland's local authorities will be represented.
I was actually going to bring you in any event because it's about your views on overt carriage and your report from the inspectorate. You said that it's the best and safest method of carriage, and more broadly we consider that overt carriage of ARV duties promotes openness and transparency with the public, following which Police Scotland were considering their position with regard to this, and as I understand, perhaps it was covert. And what I was looking at is, I believe that DCC Livingstone were going to present something to the SPA's senior leadership on the 18th of March, in other words, yesterday. So putting it to both of you, I'd like to know how matters have progressed Because you indicated first Mr. Penman, yourself, and then DCC Higgins, if you can give us an idea where that has come, because there seems to be a conflict or a potential conflict here between your views.
Thanks. If I could just cover off the localism issue before I answer that, if I can. It's just, again, in addition to the work from the authority and also Police Scotland, we have a divisional inspection programme where we go around each of the divisions and each local authority. So we're also very keen to make sure that the engagement between Police Scotland and the authority is taken account of. And we're also very keen to promote localism and effectively encourage local authorities to be less passive and to actually start to be more demanding of Police Scotland in the future. So that's a theme that we will be looking at as the weeks and months go on. In relation to the point from the convener, where we were coming from is, I think we covered it slightly in the last session, is yes. That we felt overt carriage is the safest because there are operational issues around where it's drawn from on the body, and the safest way to do that, that I'm sure ACC Higgins will cover off. Our view about transparency was, I think, that now you know the public are very much aware of armed policing, and I think actually overt carriage is something that people understand. We would have some concerns, I think, if it moved to covert carriage, that I think that if that did happen, Police Scotland would have to make absolutely sure people understood what that was about, because I think it could be misinterpreted, if you like, or could damage public confidence if people felt that many police officers had guns but they just couldn't see them. I think Mr. Higgins' position, I think, from the last time was around it was one of a number of options that they would consider in order to have an informed way forward.
Yeah,
got you. I'll respond, convener, if I can, because the just to be clear in terms of the our own internal sort of chronology, it was a Police Scotland only leadership board that we met yesterday and discussed the two elements, was the mode of carriage and also the default activity when not a threat to life, the issue I discussed with Ms. McInnes earlier. The next stage for us, because this was by definition an options appraisal on both these points, and there's lots of detail in regard to both. And in terms of the mode of carriage, we note the HMI's position and we note some of the comments that members have made in that regard. But it would only be right and proper, given the comments and observations on governance, given the comments and observations on the need for the SPA to be rigorous, that we next take those two reports to the SPA, and we're going to do that on the 31st of this month. And as I recall, we did outline that quite clearly at the last session, and I apologise if there was ambiguity around that, but we were quite clear that there was an internal goal group that I chair, an internal Police Scotland leadership group, and this is our own internal governance, and then we take that to the authority. And I don't think it would be appropriate until we go to the authority.
I'm sorry. It's just that my papers tell me it was to go to the SPA Senior Leadership Board on 18th March. So I'll have some of our clerking team just check whether that's wrong from the evidence previously or whether, in fact, something has changed. And I'm not being accusatory. It's just that's what I have before me. That's why I was asking.
I can absolutely categorically assure you that this the process and the time frame was always my gold group into the leadership board of the force executive, the force cabinet, if you like, and then to the authority SP. At the end
so,
of the month.
Well, we'll check it out.
So
just
it may be too many dates, but it was always clear, uh-huh. And I think it's right and proper that we do that with the authority, recognising right. Some of the observations that we've had around the mode of carriage.
I beg your pardon, I'm trying to move on.
If it's helpful, convener, that's exactly
that's your
my understanding too.
Well, we'll clarify what it is. I've got John and then Kevin, then I'll take you, Graham, and Roderick, and then I'll take Alison back. And if you're content with that order, Alison. Right, John.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon, panel. Mr. Whyte, I want to return to the issue of the report, and firstly, can I thank you for the comprehensive update you provided in the letter of 16th March, which I'm always learning new terms. I learnt a new one from your letter, and that is dynamic drafting process. So we understand from previous discussions that there was some discussion about the original report, and if I quote from your letter, you talk about factual and policy engagement with Police Scotland. Can you just give a brief outline of what was involved in that, please?
Well, we sent the report to Police Scotland for factual accuracy checking. There were items, I think, within it around some of the kind of issues that Ms. McInnes has been into today around carriage and so on, where we wanted to check things. So those would be policy issues within Police Scotland, and perhaps not policies, maybe the wrong word, operating procedures is probably more accurate around those.
Okay, thank you very much. And I mean, you're keen to be open and transparent about this entire process?
Yes.
Yes. That being the case, would you make available to the committee the changes that did take place, the tracked changes, if you like? I'm sure there'll be a process to show what the original report comprised of and the subsequent changes that took place and who requested these changes. I know you say that the report ultimately has the full endorsement, but that would be helpful to understand the changes that did take place. I mean, we all write reports and there can be errors in reports, but that would be helpful if you could make that available to the committee.
Well, there can be errors and reflections, convener, and that I think the board subgroup that took this on did have all of those types of discussions. If the subcommittee wishes to make that request, then I'm clearly we'll carefully consider that, and I think that's a matter for you, convener, and I'm happy to take that away to consider further with the chair of the SPA and our chief executive, and we can then respond on that.
You certainly wouldn't see some of the track changes in our reports discussed in private, where we battle over a conjunction.
The difficulty, convener, is there's not inconsiderable policy implications for us about releasing all of the details.
So you can't make a commitment, you've got to take it back,
Yeah.
Well, I'm grateful if you'd give that consideration, Mr. Whyte. Yeah. I think that the spirit in which the engagement continues henceforth, as has been alluded to, I think is very important. If I can turn to a question for Mr. Penman, please. And you have said, Mr. Penman, we're further on. And I think you do talk about wishing that the police authorities to be more demanding. I'm very keen that we move this issue on. But I think we can only move it on if we understand the process that took us here. Would you, in turn, provide to the committee your understanding of when the various changes took place, who requested them, who was consulted on them, and any feedback about that? That may have been something, indeed, you'll have pulled together in relation to your report you did last year. But if you could make that available, that would be very helpful.
Yeah, so just understanding the scope of that, what we were clear about in our scope was we gave a description in the report about what the situation was prior to Police Scotland in terms of each of the legacy forces, who had ERVs, whether it was overt and covert. So that information was contained within that. In terms of the Police Scotland's decision-making and authorities' decision-making, I think we captured that within the timeline in the report. So I'm just want to clarify with you, Mr. Finney, what additional information you might be looking for.
Well, remind me, because unfortunately I don't have it in front of me here, Mr. Penman, but for instance, there's been issues about who was told, when they were told, and who made the decision. And we touched on that last time, and there were different versions. I mean, I've been told it's Mr. Graham that made the decision in respect of Northern, been told it's Mr. House that made the decision, told different times about that. So some timeline, from memory that wasn't in your report, but some timeline of when the change actually took place, who made that decision and who was consulted in that decision? That would be very helpful.
Is that specifically in terms of Legacy Northern?
No, Tayside as well, I think, would be helpful.
Because what we said in the scope, it's evidence we haven't looked at in detail because we didn't take it within the scope of our review. Our review was very much based on who made the decisions within Police Scotland and how that was communicated, and that's where the timeline exists. So we actually excluded from the review looking at legacy arrangements and who was said and who was notified and who weren't. We gave a factual position of what armed response vehicles existed within the area. That's in the report. We gave a timeline with the police, Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland, but we didn't go back, and nor do we have that information currently around all of the legacy police boards.
I think, too, of course, the point is we are here to scrutinise Police Scotland, legacy forces.
But if I may, convener, this issue has its genesis in advance of that. And what we've heard is that there was a difficulty about the level of scrutiny. Indeed, that's reflected in the Police Authority's report. So
Mr.
I'm keen
Penman's
that we meet forward,
answer,
but to know the problems that created the difficulty we're in are being addressed by the new arrangements. We need to know what these previous issues were.
With respect, I think that's covered off in our report. What our report shows is the genesis of a decision within Police Scotland, the timings of that, the decision by the Chief Constable, and I think there's a recognition in our report, and certainly criticism in our report, to the extent to which that was communicated locally and to the authority. What we didn't go into, because actually there's no agreement for us to do, was what were all the different legacy decisions within each of the legacy forces. Northern, clearly, as you're aware of, was done very close to that. Some stuff was done
How close, Mr. Penman?
My understanding, again, I think it was the month before. I think it was the 1st of March, I think. So it would have been a month before, I think, that the ARV situation changed within Northern. But what seems we didn't specifically go into the scope of legacy force arrangements because we felt what was relevant in this was more the decision in relation to Police Scotland and the authority and how that was communicated moving forward.
I want to, in ECC Livingstone and John, who wants. Thank you.
Just to assist Mr. Finney and be absolutely clear, up until midnight on the 1st of April 2013, the operational responsibility for all the legacy force areas rested and remained in practice, in law, in reality, with the legacy chief constable that was in place at the time. Mr. House, Sir Stephen as he is now, was absolutely clear on that. And we as a group, this was the transition. There was a number of issues that we were going to, there was going to be a change of structure, of format regarding major crime, regarding our response to rape, regarding ARVs. But the changes that Sir Stephen as Chief Constable instructed were only those that took place after the 1st of April 2013, because in law they were the only ones that he could. And the, some of the legacy chiefs quite rightly guarded their responsibilities very dearly up until the changeover, because they knew that they retained that vicarious responsibility and they retained that responsibility to their communities. So Sir Stephen, the Chief Constable, was only in charge and only took decisions after Police Scotland went live.
So it was Mr. Graham that took the decision. Sorry.
Well, as I recall the circumstances, because I was living and breathing through at the time, it was Mr. Cowie who was acting chief of Northern at that time. It was ex officio. It was the chief constables of the legacy forces who were in charge of their resources prior to Police Scotland starting.
My understanding is that Mr. Cowie took over on the 1st of March. The policy, I think, took effect on the 1st of March. Therefore, all the planning and preparation and decisions before that would have been taken at a time when Mr. Graham was the Chief Constable in that area. But I think it may be helpful, Mr. Finney, if I can understand what it is you're looking for. Perhaps with the committee, I could see if we can find that information for you.
To come through me on behalf of the committee, so if you want to clarify even further,
John. Well, no, I'm grateful for clerks and indeed colleagues. Of course, part of the process we're here is everyone who may be, have an interest in this isn't sitting with a copy of your report. So it's important that we do get some of the information on the record, as you'll understand, which is why I'm asking questions, the answers to which may be self-evident, but that's nonetheless, and it is to understand process. So my final question on that is, would you have anticipated that the convener of the Northern Joint Police Board would have been aware of that change?
From my perspective, that would have been a decision for the Chief Constable at that time to put forward in terms of that going forward. So, and I'm not sure how that was communicated or if it was communicated.
I want to just clarify something because I was challenging you on timescales, and I think there was, it's a bit ambiguous here. I asked, what is the timescale for the report that you will circulate internally and then to the SPA? To which it was actually ACC Higgins that said it will go internally to Mr. Livingstone's Go Group on 11th March, subject to discussions at the Go Group. It will then be presented to the Senior Leadership Board on 18th March. Thereafter, again, subject to the Board's discussions, I believe it will notionally be provided to the meeting of the Police Authority at the end of March. So you're quite right. I just want to make it clear that there had been some ambiguity. So absolutely the case.
I have some questions on carriage, if I may.
Yes, yep, okay. And then Thank Kevin. I don't know if I'm going to have time for Roderick and Graham at that point.
Mr. Higgins, and the question of safe carriage, that is the number one priority, as I understand from yourself.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, that and transparency with the public.
Indeed. Now, there is a view, given the circumstances you've outlined there, a view could be taken that nothing's really changed at all. Police officers are always police officers. If they happen to have a firearm strapped on, it doesn't stop them being a police officer.
No, I mean, I think we've made it quite clear what their operating parameters are. I mean, again, so there is absolutely no ambiguity, Mr. Finney. They will deal with firearms incidents, they will deal with threat to life incidents, and they will use their professional judgment over other things that occur in front of them. Now, on occasion, they will simply issue a warning, they will simply take no action, but on other occasions, they will formally interject in a situation as they see fit. But yes, they are police officers first and foremost, and yes, they do carry a firearm, and it is a very, very difficult job they do. That's why we give them the intense training that we do, and that's why we test their understanding, knowledge and ability to carry out that job as frequently and as intrusively as we do.
So if, for instance, there were to be a breach of the peace in Inverness High Street, similar to the incident that prompted the press photograph that's been made, could we anticipate three armed officers attending that?
Well, I think, again, if you want to be specific about that incident, that related to a well-known violent hotspot where my understanding is that routinely there are fights outside that particular premise. And when does a breach of the peace suddenly become a serious assault? When does a serious assault suddenly become an attempt murder? And when, sadly, does a fight in the street end up in the tragic death of somebody? If you're asking me, do I want my firearms officers to prevent somebody escalating through that street fight to potentially a murder inquiry, then absolutely. One of their duties is to protect life. And if that means that they have to break up a fight in the street where somebody is clearly getting a bit of a beating, then that's absolutely their job, yes.
And that point, again, just to reiterate, is exactly what we're going to consult upon in terms of my previous conversation I had with Ms. McInnes, that criteria about that spontaneous deployment, so that communities, representatives, police officers themselves, communities, citizens, our families, your families, everybody can contribute to that, and we have a criteria that's agreed upon, and we undertook to do that, and we will do that.
But Mr. Penman as well, unless he wants to come in.
Just to a point, I mean, this is something, again, that we raised in our armed policing report, paragraph 66. We recognised that, you know, Police Scotland were quite clear around the criteria around firearms incident, threat to life, and things you would come across from that. I mean, our view, or my view in that as well, is in an example of a breach of the peace, if officers are passing that and they see it, I think there's a real issue around public confidence if a marked police vehicle drives by that, you know, which is why we recognise. I think there's a communications issue to make sure people understand that officers who are armed may then be involved in that, and I think that is part of the briefing and part of our recommendation. But I would have a view that it was quite clear in terms of the criteria it was set that these things would happen, and again I have a real concern that if they weren't doing that, you'd have officers driving by things and the public really wouldn't understand what that was about, and it could be contrary to public confidence.
I would also say that's exactly the way it was described to us, both in writing and verbally by the Chief Constable at our October meeting, and that this fits with that. I would also go slightly further in that in our report, when we asked the public, we found that over 70% suggested that were they to call the police, and the nearest and quickest way of getting them a police officer was for a firearms officer to attend, then they would be content with that. So that goes actually further than this deployment method that Police Scotland are using.
Yeah, well, for the avoidance of doubt, I would expect every police officer to do their duty. If officers are dealing with a minor breach of the peace, which they want to stop becoming a major breach of the peace, if your two of your armed response vehicle officers are dealing with that, and a call comes in about someone with a samurai sword elsewhere, who's going to go to that incident, Mr. Higgins?
Well, that's Hobson's choice, Mr. Finney. That's, again, when their professional judgment comes down. One of the things that the officers will do immediately when they deploy to break up that breach of the peace is shout in and ask for assistance from local officers to come and assist them. It goes back down to where is the greatest threat to life. The greatest threat to life is clearly the individual with the samurai sword.
As you may be aware, Mr. Higgins, I was a dog handler for 10 years, and I supported colleagues. By supporting colleagues, it didn't mean that I took, if there was an incident, a domestic incident, if there was a violent incident, I would assist colleagues. It didn't always mean that I took my dog out of the vehicle.
No.
I think you're challenging, and you're absolutely entitled to do that, the rationale and the raison d'etre behind the standing authority. Now,
I'm coming to challenging it.
The chief constable has taken a view, based on all the threat and risk that exist, based on the requirement to provide a level of support for the very high threats and risks that are real and exist, that we need that standing authority. That's been validated on a professional basis by the work that the HMI has carried out, and that standing authority, with the provision of that 24/7 ARV coverage, remains in place. What we are clearly now looking to consult upon and engage with colleagues and communities on is the mode of carriage, which we've discussed, and what profile of incident that ARV officers may deal with that are not threat to life and are not specific firearms incidents, but these are ones that are spontaneous ones. But what's clear
and it must remain so, is that the standing authority is based on the assessment of threat and risk that the Chief Constable must take. He must carry out that assessment. We will consult thereafter on the deployment, and the process for that has been validated by the work that both the Police Authority and the HMI have carried out.
Is the risk assessment Scotland only, or is it very specific? Because it seems to me that the risk in Loch Inver might be different from the risk in Leith.
Part of the strategic threat assessment, Mr Finney, looks at Scotland as a whole, but then it breaks it down into particular areas. And we look at things like the serious organised crime groups that have access to firearms. We look at the number of legally held firearms where they are across the country. We look at the vulnerable sites that are plotted against the country, across the country, that might need that firearm support in terms of a severe terrorist threat. And what we have concluded quite categorically is that the firearms threat, both domestically from serious organised crime and from terrorism, exists in all parts of Scotland. And as such, the Standing Firearms Authority is appropriate for all parts of Scotland. And again, that was independently validated by the work that Mr Penman and his team undertook when they did their audit of the Standing Firearms Authority.
No, just to that, we offered an assurance role, and we examined the ESTRA, the strategic assessment, and other intelligence products that were there for that. But obviously, it wasn't just ourselves. We also had DCC Simon Chesterman, who was the ACPO lead, who also examined that documentation as well and came to the same conclusion as ourselves. The other thing probably for us would be an interest in transparency, because obviously that's a document that isn't shared publicly. We recommended that a member of the Police Authority should attend these meetings and be able to witness for themselves what that threat was, and understand that the Chair of the Police Authority has already attended one of those meetings since our recommendations were made.
Do you ever envisage a situation where there will be a return in the Highlands Islands to officers being deployed in an armed response vehicle where the weapons are retained in the boot, meaning that they can attend all of these incidents, including subsequently firearms incidents, without any of the concerns? The Chief Constable said to one of the committees on the 30th of October, what the hell are these cops doing in relation to not participating? Well, I have to tell you, most folks say to me when they come across cops at filling stations, they tell me, what the hell are these cops doing having a firearm on in the Highlands of Scotland?
As the threat and risk that exists at the moment, I don't envisage that change being made. But you know as well as anybody, Mr. Finney, we constantly keep the matter under review, and we will continue to do so. But we do so because it's our duty to protect the public. We don't do so because we want our officers to have guns. We do so because our judgment is that that's the best way to keep people safe right across the whole of Scotland.
I appreciate it's an ongoing assessment. Thank you.
I'm sorry, as usual, I'm trying to get everyone in. Kevin, next, please.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, can I ask Mr. Whyte, Mr. Penman, and DCC Livingstone how many complaints their organisations have had from members of the public regarding armed officers? Mr. Whyte?
I'm not sure we've directly had any. I would imagine complaints would go direct to Police Scotland, and indeed if it were a complaint about something like that, we would direct it to Police Scotland for
Thank
them
you.
To answer.
People take different routes to complain, Mr. Whyte, as yeah. you well know. Mr. Penman, please.
We have no statutory role in terms of complaints, so in my personal knowledge, I'm not aware of any. That's not to say correspondence may have come in about that, so I will check and I'll feed that back in.
Thank
just
you.
To
Thank
make
you.
Sure.
DCC Livingstone, please.
Figures and ACC Higgins has them right Thank on you. His fingertips, I think.
Yes, I have received 27 complaints specifically about the Standing Firearms Authority and disagreement with that particular policy since May last year. And again, contextually, Police Scotland in the same period have received roughly about 5,000 complaints for all matters ranging from incivility to excessive force. And out that figure of just around about 5,000, 27 of them refer to specific complaints about the Standing Firearms Authority.
And were these specific complaints where these folks were involved in something where they seen an officer, or is it, was it general complaints about the policy?
It was a mixture of both, Mr. Stewart. Some of them were exactly as you've described, a member of the public that seen a person at a filling station and didn't disagree, or more commonly what it was that somebody that had read in the media what the policy was and was simply writing in to complain that they disagreed with that particular policy.
Thank you. We've heard a lot about professional judgment, and ACC Higgins, you've stated that armed response officers have more situational awareness training than other police officers. What does that actually involve, Mr. Higgins, and can you give us an idea of how long that training is and what they go through in terms of that training?
Yeah, certainly, Mr. Stewart. I mean, an initial armed response officer, ARV officer, will take 9 weeks to complete their training. Now, clearly, part of that training is about weapon handling and actually being physically capable of shooting the weapon, but actually to drill right down to it, they get 5.5 days in a classroom of theory around situational awareness, about assessment, about decision-making, and then they get 22 days of actual practical application where, again, they're given exercises and their decision-making is tested. Once they have qualified as an armed response vehicle, they have to refresh over the course of the year, and as well as having to undertake 3 qualifying shoots to maintain their standard of shooting, they undertake 9 days of additional developmental training where, again, their situational awareness, their decision-making, their professional assessment is tested.
So
just to satisfy, I'm not cutting you short, Kevin.
Okay.
I was just indicating you'll be time for a short supplementary, Alison, and I'll try to get both of you in as well by extending it a little longer.
So it would be fair to say, without casting aspersions on other police officers, that these are some of the best trained police officers within the force?
Unquestionably. I mean, if I can give you an example, some months ago, two of my officers were attacked in the Mound in Edinburgh by a man with a knife. They were firearms officers. They'd been stopped by a member of the public who said there's a gentleman there who appears to be distressed. As they got out of the vehicle, the man ran at them and started to try and stab them. One of my officers was stabbed 4 times. Now, despite being stabbed 4 times, despite suffering a frenzied attack, both officers still used their professional assessment and their judgment. And in my view, they could have been justified in using their conventional weapon against that individual, but they didn't. And they brought him under control and subdued him by other means. When I then spoke to them and asked them why, both of them independently of each other said the reason was not so much what was in front of us, we could see what the guy was doing and we wouldn't have missed him because it was too close, but behind him was lots of members of the public. And had we shot that individual, potentially one of the members of the public would have been struck by the bullet that would have gone through him. So even under the most intense frenzied attack, the training that these officers received allowed them to make an assessment and they realised that they could not go to their conventional weapon. That was a terrible, terrible incident, but if nothing else, it absolutely assured me of the, firstly, the courage of the officers, but actually their utmost professionalism, even in the most intense of circumstances.
I think, you know, everyone would agree that those actions are to be applauded, and that level of situational awareness in a situation such as that is pretty immense. In terms of officers coming across things and in front of them and dealing with them, if they weren't to do so, it has been said that that would be seen as by the public as a neglect of duty. And that the force itself would likely lose trust if officers were seen nearby and not responding to particular incidents. What have you got to say about those folks, of which there are a few, who've said that no armed officer should ever deal with anything other than a situation where there are lives at risk?
I would disagree with them, firstly, Mr. Stewart. I mean, I think there's two elements to that. They have a professional duty, but actually the firearms officers are very passionate about what they do, but they're also very humane about what they do. Recently in Dumfries, some months ago during the bad weather, they came across an elderly lady that had slipped in the ice and broken their hip. They got out, they covered her in blankets, they gave her emergency first aid, and they waited until the paramedics came to take her to hospital. That's not a police matter in general terms, but, I mean, who would want the police officers to drive by that? Certainly not me.
In terms of the threat assessment that's undertaken, and we've heard from Mr. Finney that that may be different from Leith compared to Loch Inver, but, you know, from experiences that have happened over the years, St Andrews featured the other week, and of course one of the worst incidents that we've ever seen involving firearms in this country was in Dunblane. Do you think it is right that we look at threat right across the country, and that nobody could ever say that the threat differential from rural to urban, there's a wide gulf there?
The threat is real, and it's genuine. If you look at Scotland as a whole, there's not a single area that you could, in all consciousness, in terms of discharging your duty, exclude from that. You just need to look internationally about the level of threat. The threat from international terrorism, the capability and the profile, the very, very diverse nature of that threat is real. The threat from organised crime. I think I talked about a crime group from Merseyside that specifically targeted the Highlands. Operation Cambridge was the name of that operation. It was well publicised in the Press and Journal a few weeks ago. So we know that the requirement for armed officers, a small minority of armed officers, to mitigate that threat, to support the unarmed service, the men and women that work in our communities, live in our communities, is absolutely critical. There is scope at times for differences, undoubtedly, across the whole of Scotland. I accept that. We accept that. I don't think the armed response vehicles, the specialist nature of that, is one area that we would want to make that differential.
Thank you. My final question is for Mr. Whyte, convener. And obviously, in terms of the reporting from Police Scotland to the SPA regarding matters of significant public interest, and you called it the significant public interest test, if I remember rightly, do you think that you maybe require a significant political interest test as well? Because I think that sometimes this political bubble drives things to a greater extent than public interest actually does.
Well, convener, Mr. Stewart may have a point there.
Dangerous for you to answer.
But I don't think that's for me to say directly. It's absolutely clear that matters that are taken up by politicians become matters of public interest. The two are intertwined, and the media has a role within that too. So I think all three of them combine to become a test of public interest.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Bear with me. I've tried to a little long, but I've promised Alison back.
Thank you. Well, let me first of all say I commend the courage of those officers that you described in the Edinburgh incident, absolutely, of course. But you have repeatedly stressed that the situational judgment of these officers, and I don't doubt that it's something that they're trained in. But I have here two critical and quite disturbing police investigations and review commissioner reports from last year. One, a firearms incident on, near Daviot, and one, a firearms incident in Kinghorn and Fife. Now, the one in Daviot, a 91-year-old man was driving his car on the northbound carriageway of the A9 near Inverness. He was stopped by armed officers of Police Scotland. Four police officers pointed their guns at the man and detained him. Now, the recommendations in that report say that Police Scotland should review the actions of some of the officers involved in this incident and examine the wider issues raised. And then the other report...
First, I'm sorry, okay. It's just that you were about this. That's a serious case. Okay. Your comments on that first, please.
Thank you, convener. I think, yes, I'm familiar with that one. What the PIRP review actually said, that at the time, based on the information the firearms officers had at that time, then their actions were absolutely appropriate. As soon as there was criticism of Police Scotland in terms of the intelligence that was held, the information was held, and how quickly or otherwise that was passed to the firearms officers. But the other point of that particular incident is that, yes, they did point the weapon at the man. And as soon as he exited the vehicle, They used their assessment, their judgment, and they immediately lowered their weapons when they saw he was a 91-year-old gentleman.
Well, did you examine the wider issues raised, and did it provide additional training to the officers undertaking the role of initial tactical firearms officer commander? Did that happen?
Yes, it did. Yeah. I chaired a goal group in respect of this incident. As I said, there were issues around the communication exchange between control rooms in Stirling and in the Aberdeen area. But actually, if we're talking about the pure firearms operation, then the pure firearms operation complied with the College of Policing guidelines. The manner in which they stopped the vehicle, the manner in which they challenged the gentleman were absolutely appropriate. And as I said, as soon as they saw what was in front of them and assessed the threat that they were being presented with, they immediately lowered their weapons.
And the key thing on that is that actually was, that was a firearms incident that they were sent, sent to. The learning for us was about the communication between the intelligence and then the initial tactical firearms commander.
I'm going to, in fairness, I know you've got onto something, but I've got two people who've sat here through the entire meeting, and I would, in fairness, because you've done this before, let you both ask questions and have answers on the record, if you'll forgive me. And that's Graeme, if you'll ask your question, and then Roderick, because I mean, I don't want to exclude you. You're very patient. You've been here before, right?
No, it's been worth attending. It's been a worthwhile exercise, I think. Some supplementary questions, if you would allow me, I'd supply to you in writing.
If you can put down, and then if Grover agrees, and we'll try and get some answers.
The one question I'll try with just now, and it's for Mr. Whyte, you won't be surprised I'm back to speak to him again. One of the key factors in support of the creation of the single police force was the need for an improvement in governance and accountability, which is deemed to be a weakness in the eight previous force arrangements. Now, we've heard from police evidence today about the need for quite clear ways forward, clarity and no ambiguity. I've got to say that the answer to my question from the last session told me a lot about lessons learned, about engagement, about consultation, significant public interest, shared accountability and agreement. It didn't tell me who had the authority to make the decision on the 1st of April, 2 years ago, about changing policy in relation to firearms. Now, you talked about a shared accountability agreement. If something is shared, in my experience, no one ends up with responsibility. Does the authority now accept the responsibility for not only holding the Chief Constable to account, but for ensuring that when the Chief Constable makes significant policy changes, the authority is consulted thoroughly and that you will endorse that change before it happens?
Well, the short answer is yes, Convener. I would say there are, on the firearms issue, there are some specifics which I think are laid out in Mr. Penman's report where there are specific legal implications and decisions given to the Chief Constable about the Standing Firearms Authority. Yeah. But in general terms and policy, I think it's very important that we as an authority have oversight of policy, if nothing else, than to give the public assurance that what the Chief Constable was doing is the right thing to do, and to give, in often cases, to give backing to Police Scotland about what they're doing.
I just want to say one sentence. Can I say, just for the record, I accept that in matters of crisis and emergency, a Chief Constable needs operational independence. So accept the indication given.
No, I understand that from your own experience. Roderick.
Okay, Convener. Just wanted to ask Mr. Penman, he doesn't need to answer now, but just perhaps he could supply an answer in due course, whether he's content in terms of recommendation 7 from his report as to the speed at which deployment criteria are being understood and accepted by local communities in relation to attendance at appropriate non-firearms related incidents. And the second point I wanted to make, just following on from my colleague John Finney's comments in the history of the legacy forces, is actually just to refer to page 23 of Mr. Penman's or HMISCS's report of October, where it does indicate 30th of November 2012, that's the police chief constable, made a policy decision that at the commencement of Police Scotland, there would be a single standing authority to overtly arm all ARV officers, with a sidearm self-loading pistol and conducted energy device taser. And the footnote on the same page which says, footnote 27, Northern Constabulary granted a standing authority on the 1st of March 2013 as part of the transition to Police Scotland. Prior to this, it operated a dual-role ARV without standing authority and weapons in vehicle safe.
That would be the fourth different time, then,
evidence. We can tell he's a... Gentlemen, you're not having a wee discussion with each other.
Yeah, no,
you can tell... excuse me? You can tell that he was an advocate in that he's read every little page of it, which is a good thing. I'm going to stop the evidence session here. If you have any other additional questions, you just put them through me as convener and share them with the committee. I'm sorry I've had to do it. Thank you very much. That ends the session. Thank you for coming. I'm moving into private session, which will be